shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem is builded as a city that is compact together, whither the tribes go up, and the tribes of the Lord into the testimony of Israel, to give thanks unto the name of the Lord. For there are set thrones of judgment, and the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper, they that love Jerusalem. That's verse 6. My message is based on verse 6, 7, 8, and 9. And I'll read verse 7. Peace be within thy walls, and prosperity within thy palaces. For the brethren and the companion's sake, I will now say, peace be with thee. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I'll seek thy good. Before you sit, I would like to greet every one of you. And I would like you to help me greet you, and you greet somebody, you greet at least five people. And as we sing this chorus, the first verse we just read in Psalms 122, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Going has to do with the movement, with moving. So greet at least five people as we sing this chorus, and we are going to be led by the choir. Thanks, choir.
I was glad when they said unto me, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Let us go, let us go unto me. I was glad when they said unto me, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Let us go.
God bless you. God bless you. Thank you, choir. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. God is good all the time. That's the nature of God. Praise God. I'm so excited to be here in this church, here at Deliverance Church, Roy Sab. And I would like us to appreciate the bishop of this church, Jimmy Kemani, and his wife Alice. Let's give a clap offering to them for this great work they have done. They have come a long way. I've known them for many, many, many years, right from the humble beginning of this church. I've seen them standing for this work. Let's also give a clap offering to yourself for being supporters of this work. For this work would not have been the way it is without you. You have been supporting them, and that's why this work has grown this way, this much, because you started from a humble beginning, and you are a very important person to this church. Each one of you is a very important part of this ministry. And this reminds me of the words in the book of Psalm 61, giving a short story. Let's read that chapter. Isaiah 61. Before I read this scripture, I want us to remind ourselves of the story about Deliverance Church. I moved to USA about 25 years ago, and I've lived in USA all those years. I've been coming here and back and forth. And we left here in Kenya after having established one of our Deliverance Church branches in Ongata Rongai. We started it two couples, two families. That's how we started. And the story about Deliverance Church, it's a great story. Because personally, I came from the mainstream churches of Anglican Church. That's where I was baptized, even laid hands on. But even after all the processes of going through all that, I never realized that I wasn't born again, or I didn't know God the way I expected or the way I wanted to know God. I felt a vacuum, like I'm empty. Until one time, my cousins came to me and told me there is a church by the name of Deliverance Church meeting at Karioko. The first gathering was at a hotel in Jivaji Garden. And after they grew bigger, they moved to Karioko, where it started expanding. And at Karioko is where I went in there, and I found a different people of believers. They were speaking in tongues, dancing, rejoicing, like the way you are doing. The reason I'm giving this short story is because your bishop and his wife Alice, they have kept the vision of Deliverance Church. Praise God. The vision was with a difference. And the difference that was there, mainly major difference, was about the Holy Spirit. And that's why this scripture says, the Spirit of the Lord, that's Psalm 61, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach the good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of prison to them that are bound. Deliverance Church is about that scripture. When we started Deliverance Church branch in Phoenix, we call our church Deliverance Worship Center. The word worship, we could not leave it behind, because Deliverance Church has been a church of worshiping God. We would rather have to spend a lot of time in worship than listening to the word. So I want to encourage you, each one of you, have more time worshiping God in your life, because Deliverance Church is about knowing God personally, having to be delivered from the powers of darkness, and turning around your life to come and have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And that's what I did. I moved there in Karioko, and I couldn't understand what they're talking about. I said to myself, let me listen. And you're here and you're listening, maybe you don't know about salvation. Salvation is real. It's real. Having a change in your life, turning away from your ways, turning away from different ways that you know, and coming to the Lord Jesus Christ is key. So when I was there, I listened to the word, preaching. I went there for about 3 weeks. But what happened at the end of the third week, when I went there, I felt God talking to me. And I started hearing from God. And the leaders of the church, they asked us to go there in front to be prayed for, an altar call. And we were asked to raise up our hands, told, start, close your eyes, start thanking you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And I started speaking a language that I didn't know. I was knocked down by the power of God, and I continued talking, and the service was over. I was left there just enjoying. That's when I came to know there's salvation, there is the total deliverance in Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. So if you have not received the Holy Spirit in your life, you need to desire to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit will reveal everything. Holy Spirit will reveal all things to you. Holy Spirit will tell you all the truth. Even when you go and people try to argue about salvation, Holy Spirit will take charge, will take full control. And I remember that evening when I left for home, I was so close with my three brothers. We always could talk and talk and talk. The first time I went there in that evening around 9 at night, I told them and declared to them, I'm born again. I'm saved. They disputed. They said, no, there's nothing like that. There's nothing like that. I told them, for real, something happened. And I told them, you will see, God will take care of me. And all these years now, I've been in salvation over 40 years. And I've seen God blessing me, leading me, walking with me, and have lived a life of faith in God. And that's what God wants us to do. God has blessed me with one wife, who was in the Congregational Deliverance Church. Bishop and his wife, they know her. They have come to our home in Phoenix. We have fellowship with them. They don't forget us when they come to U.S. They are so close to us. And we have been blessed with 3 sons and a daughter. 2 of our sons are now back here after they are grown. They are settling here in Kenya after they've been out there many, many years. And the other 2 are still in the U.S. And we thank God, because God has walked with us. And we thank God for the gift of salvation. And salvation comes with a lot of blessings. Just our children who are grown, they are coming back here in Kenya because they have kept faith. And they want to be they are marrying here in Kenya. They didn't marry there. They didn't select their spouses there. They have selected their spouses here. That's a blessing. And we thank God for those blessings. And now, I moved to U.S. 25 years ago, and it has not been milk and honey. It has not been easy. Settling in America is not a simple thing. It's complicated. But God is faithful. God is faithful. When I moved to U.S., I stayed 5 years there by myself and my family here. And we had a rough time of being separated. My family here and I'm there. And I didn't have the papers of being there, living there. I was given a letter to leave the United States within certain hours. And you have to leave. Otherwise, they'll take you themselves. They'll take you back home. And I left the United States by faith. After 5 years, I was used to the system there. So when I came back here, I came by faith, trusting God. I didn't know. I wanted the unknown. And I came back here. My wife was in Britain with the 2 children, and the 2 children were here, so I came for them. And we tried to figure out what to do, but my wife had to come back. I stayed here for 2.5 years. Those 2.5 years were very rough for me, because Kenya had already changed, and I had another system in me. So I couldn't get along with the system. When you're used to a system and then someone tells you, leave that one, come back to this, and then Kenya had changed. My friends, I couldn't see them. They thought I'm changed. So they kind of abandoned me. And it was rough. It was so tough for me. I had to walk with God. And God was faithful. After the 2.5 years, God opened a door for me, my daughter, and my wife. We got visas to go back to U.S. And we thank God, because when we went back there, it was easy doing stuff because I already was used in the system. And we've seen God blessing us. And we have been blessed with, we have a church, we have businesses there, setting up a business, and that you are respected by the Americans, that you are more than an American, It takes God. It takes God. We employ, we have Kenyans whom we have employed in our business. Our business is doing good. And we thank God that every Sunday we don't miss a Sunday because of those businesses. They are so intensive and so keep us so busy. But we thank God that we have time to go to God's house. Now, the message that I have today is about peace. Peace is very, very important to us. It's actually, according to Galatians 5:22, one of the fruits of the Holy Spirit. We need peace. And peace is key in our lives. Because we are filled with the Holy Spirit, we should pursue peace and have it continually in us. Peace is essential as important as food that we eat, even like the air that we breathe. Peace. Right now, I'm preaching this word about peace. None of us have not been a victim of not having peace. There are so many stealers of our peace, even when we come. And that's why the word of God is telling us, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Because in the house of the Lord is where you restore your peace. You have your peace restored because there are so many stealers of stealing the peace that you have. The peace is stolen in very many ways. Very many ways. We have couples, we have a marriage, there's a couple, a mother and a father, relationship, not doing well, or argument in the family. Peace is stolen. How do you handle that? So peace is very, very important. They are the parents and the children, in our places of work, in our neighborhood. We find peace that we have is stolen. Even like nationwide or like Kenya, peace is stolen in very many ways. We realize, and I realize, I say again, Kenyans have been blessed. Over years, sometimes ago when I used to come, I used to feel like I don't want to come back here because I find things are not working, they're not connecting. The culture of people, the way they talk, the way they dress, the way they drive, the way they communicate, I felt now there's a lot to be done. But thank God, Kenyans have come a long way. You've done well. God bless you. You have nice cars. You have nice houses. And the technology has brought a lot of changes. Changes that are actually connecting Kenya with the world. And connecting with the other world, you become the same level. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised that in about 40, 50 years, Kenya will be a first world country. A first world country. Because the progress Kenyans have made is great. It's tremendous. And I'm surprised when I walk around, I find somebody with a cart, mkokoteni, with a cell phone talking. That's great. I couldn't believe it. So, now, peace in the country is very, very important. Pray for the leaders. Leaders, political leaders, leaders that are there in government, the national government, the county government. Pray for those leaders so that there shall be peace. Because when there is peace, good things come. Blessings come. So continue praying for peace of our country. And as we read about the scripture, Psalms 122, it's mentioning about Jerusalem. Jerusalem, I had the opportunity to travel to Jerusalem the past 2 years. It's in Israel. Twice now, being there for 11 days on each of them with my wife and a group of other Kenyans, like about 40 of us. We go there. Israel is a great country. It's the Bible land. It's a place where we need to pray for. And it's a place where people go there to see the wonders of God. People there, the words that we see, the Bible that we see, it's all there, including small streets, including the people you talk to. When you ask somebody, they are quoting names that you already know. It's a blessed country. But even though blessed, there are indicators that there is no peace in certain areas. Those are, because it's a country that is a blessing set aside by God, there are people who are, the mixture of the people, there are Muslims, there are Armenians, there are people of different faith. Even Ethiopians are there. I'll quote an example of Bethlehem, where our Lord Jesus Christ was born. To reach out there to that place, it's a very small place whereby the actual place where he was born. But to reach out there, you go to queue. You go to make a long queues for you to reach there. And people go there just to have a touch of that place. Just to experience the touch of that place. And all the time there are priests all around that place offering sacrifices, praying and dressing in robes. And that place, now to reach that place is occupied by Muslims, not Christians. So there is so much division in that country that we need to pray for. Anything, when we mention peace, of course there are wars. It looks like there are a war can break in a time. And if that is touched, Jerusalem is touched, there will be no peace in the whole world. That's why even like Trump, the president of the United States of America, when he mentioned that he wanted to have the embassy or the capital to be moved from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, it becomes a big problem. Because the peace will be disrupted. We were living in a hotel that is in Bethlehem, just a few yards from where our Lord Jesus Christ was born. But that place is full of, like, the mosque, the speakers. You can't even sleep. Speakers are all over. They are big speakers are all over. And this reminds us of that we need to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Because there's no peace. Also, this reminds us that we have the spiritual Jerusalem, which includes you and me as a believer. There are so many things that are going on around the church that needs prayers, that needs us to stand in the gap to pray for the peace of the spiritual Jerusalem. Leaders or pastors are divided. Leaders are divided. They don't have unity. The word of God tells us, behold how good it is, Psalms 133, how good it is for brethren to dwell together in unity, for God commands blessing. We need to pray for this unity so that there shall be peace. Pray for the peace of the spiritual Jerusalem. Pray for the leader, praying for the church. And because of the divisions and war that are among the Christians, that's why you find even like we are not doing very well when it comes to evangelism. You're not doing as much as the Muslims. I'm surprised about, like, there used to be very few when I got born again. Like Ongata Ronga, there used to be only one mosque. Today, there are about almost like 10. They are expanding very fast. So we need to pray for the peace of Jerusalem, spiritual Jerusalem, so that we can have the work of God continue on like God had planned. And so, when we speak, we talk of peace. Peace starts within yourself. You cannot get peace outside yourself. It all depends on you yourself. You make a decision about you are going to pursue peace. Pursue peace with all you can, with all diligence, with all your effort. Pursue peace. Peace that God has given us when we get born again. The peace through Jesus Christ, the peace that surpasses all human understanding will come upon us. And that we be the one who are in the book of Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. Let's read that. Matthew chapter 5. It's good to read the word of God together in the church because you may not have time to read it by yourself. So even reading the word of God together is very important. Chapter 5. Chapter 5, verse 9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are the, you shall be blessed if you pursue peace. If you be the part of the one to be a peacemaker. Peacemaker in your home. Peacemaker to your children. You'll be blessed if you be the one who is the lead, in the lead. Peace with your co-workers in your place of work. Be the one to bring peace, not the one to actually make the problem bigger. Peace everywhere, in the neighborhood. Be a peacemaker. Be the one to carry that peace. The word of God tells us, peace without God, no man shall see God. If you want others to see who, what you believe and that you believe in God, be a peacemaker. Be the one who is carrying the peace everywhere. And God is counting on us between a husband and wife. And the way to do it is be a vessel that is ready to be used by God to be a peacemaker, to carry the peace, to have the peace. And this, there are many ways of how to do this to when your peace is stolen. And there are so many things that steal your peace. One of the ways is to be very close to God, walking with God, talking to God, believing the word, meditating upon the word. As you meditate upon the word, meditation, not just the word. And this I do personally myself. At the end of the day, after a long day, you have worked so hard and you feel frustrated and you've been going through a lot. Don't just eat and sleep. Relax somewhere, by yourself all alone, and start to pray, to thank God. And as you do that, you experience such a peace that cannot be understood by human understanding, because there'll be restoration of peace. Meditating, having time alone. Having time alone uninterrupted. Have a time like I do it in the U.S. after I go through a lot and I feel like my peace is taken away, stolen. I make a decision. I'm just going to prayer walk. I like prayer walk. Prayer walk, like even around here, you can have a prayer walk. And the benefits of prayer walk is there are so many benefits, including you're doing exercise. You are doing yourself good to your body. Take time to go to Karura Forest. Go there, nature of God, or in a park. Pray. Start talking to God, or sit down somewhere. Meditate upon the word of God. Read the word of God. Peace shall be restored back to you. And when you get out of that place, you'll be a different person. And as you go to this, back to the situation that you are in that stole your peace, you'll be confident. God will use you now to bring peace to that situation. And you'll be the one to bring that peace in that situation. So peace is key. There's no way we can talk about salvation or talk about we walk with God without peace. It's a very important element in our life. If we are the peacemakers, we'll make a difference in this world. We'll be what God wants us to be. God wants us to be the light of the world and the salt of the world. Peace is key in every area of our lives. It's key. It will bring a difference. It will make other people attracted to you. Those who are not born again, they will come and inquire from you that they want to be born again. They want to know or to get what you have. And this you can practice in your day-to-day life. I've been around and I use a lot of bring your peace and start praising God, talking to God, singing choruses. And there shall be restoration of peace within yourself. And that way you'll continue wanting to walk and walk with God. May God bless you. Let's all rise up. Hallelujah. Let's all rise up. I would like us to participate to this prayer. We have heard the message from God. Let's individually go before God. Close your eyes and pray for the peace of Jerusalem, both the physical in Israel and also to pray for the spiritual Jerusalem. Let's go before the Lord, each one of us, and talk to God about it. Hallelujah, King of Glory. Oh, Harabashika, Rababa, 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 Rababa. Hallelujah, 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 King of Glory. We give you praise, we give you glory, we give you honor, oh Jehovah God Almighty. We exalt, oh God Almighty, we glorify the mighty God, Jehovah God, because God, you are a God in our lives. We thank you, Lord God Almighty, because you are our peace. You have brought peace, mighty God, and to us, mighty God, I pray that God Almighty, this, the peace of God that surpasses all human understanding shall be upon every one of us, mighty God, upon this church, upon the leaders of this church, upon every member of this church, mighty God. I pray for the peace that surpasses human understanding. In the name of Jesus, they shall experience the peace of God, mighty God. The peace, mighty God. Hallelujah. God Almighty, we thank you, King of Glory, because of speaking to us at this time, mighty God. I pray for a blessing upon every family, every situation, mighty God, represented in this church, that, mighty God, peace has been stolen. We pray for a restoration, mighty God, for that family that have lost their loved one, for that family they have a dispute in their marriage, for that family, mighty God, they have a dispute between the parents and the children. God, intervene in the name of Jesus. Intervene in the name of Jesus. There's nothing too hard for you, God Almighty. We pray, mighty God, that this peace, mighty God, shall be in our lives, mighty God, and be with us, mighty God, continually. Not just momentarily, but continue. Help us, mighty God, to work for this peace. Help us to work for this peace under the power of the Holy Spirit. That we will be a people that are protected from the powers of darkness. We know sometimes Satan comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy that which we have. And we pray against the powers of darkness in the name of Jesus, that God Almighty shall be protected and covered by the blood of Jesus. Even at this time, as we come to the close of this service, we pray, mighty God, that you'll walk with us, that The angels will encamp around us as we go in our homes and our by in our places of work throughout the week, mighty God. Starting, mighty God, even today, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, we shall experience God. And we shall have the peace of God that cannot be understood by human. We thank you and praise you. All this we pray, believing and trusting in Jesus' name. Amen. May God bless you, Bishop. God bless you.